Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining OSPF virtual links. One of the fundamental rules of deploying a multi-area OSPF topology is that every non-backbone area must be directly connected to the backbone area zero. Said another way, every ABR must have at least one interface on area zero. Now, this rule can be restrictive, especially if you're in the process of migrating or merging multiple networks. You might find it difficult to follow that rule as you make your network changes. In order to facilitate such changes, OSPF can use what is known as a virtual link. This is essentially between ABRs that allows you to work around this rule. Take a look at this topology here. If we were to configure these routers as OSPF routers and assign these interfaces to the indicated OSPF areas, we would have R2 and R4 as ABRs. Area 0 and Area 1 are directly connected to each other via the ABR R2, and that's an acceptable arrangement. However, Area 2 does not connect directly back to the backbone area. The ABR R4 has interfaces connected to Area 1 and Area 2, but none to Area 0, the backbone area. And that violates the rule and breaks the OSPF topology. This network will not work correctly. We can work around this by implementing a virtual link, and it looks something like this. An OSPF virtual link is something that's created between ABRs. It creates a virtual link that connects the ABR that's not connected to the backbone area zero, which is R4 in this case, to the backbone area zero, thus overcoming the rule violation. As you can see here, R4, our ABR that isn't directly connected to area zero, has a virtual link configured through another ABR. This virtual link allows R4 to logically appear as if it is part of area zero, enabling it to exchange LSAs with the backbone area. As a result, R4 now complies with OSPF's requirement that all non-backbone areas must connect to area zero. Now, before I go on, just a quick reminder. If you like what you see, consider using YouTube's Super Thanks feature to help support me. I think it's somewhere around here, down this way. It will go a long way in helping me to keep producing and improving upon these videos. Any super thanks is much, much appreciated. Okay, back to the topic at hand. Now, this here is another topology that violates this rule. Here we have two discontiguous area zeros, or backbone networks. Now, this is just a small aside. In networking, we often refer to discontiguous networks, or even discontiguous subnets. Now, some people think that this is a typo or it's incorrect and should be discontinuous. And even some spell checkers don't even know that word. But it's a real word, and it is the proper word to use here. Discontiguous refers to things that are not physically adjacent or connected. It's often used in terms of geography or layout or even memory blocks and, of course, networks. Discontinuous refers to a lack of continuity or a lack of smooth progression. Although discontinuous could be used to describe such a network, discontiguous is a more precise word to use. Now back to our topology. So according to OSPF rules, you can only have one area zero in any OSPF topology. Something like this, a discontiguous area zero, is not allowed. But something like this may be a result of a failure of one or more OSPF routers within area zero. It could be that some routers within the topology failed due to a fiber optic cable being cut or a major power outage at a data center, essentially unintentionally separating the backbone area into two. Now, regardless of the reasons behind why such a topology may exist, to resolve such a situation immediately, we can create a virtual link to unite the area zero backbones into a single backbone. This can be done with a solution like this. This is similar to the previous resolution, but it's just a different arrangement of the location of the backbone area. Now, this resolves the problem by uniting the discontiguous backbone area back into one single area, thus allowing the relevant LSAs to be distributed throughout the whole Area Zero backbone. Now, let's take a quick look at how we can configure virtual links. Now, this is the topology for which we want to configure a virtual link. Once again, remember that the configurations for the virtual link must be applied onto ABRs with the following rules. The first ABR must have at least one of its interfaces in Area Zero. This is the ABR that will provide the connection to the ABR that is violating the rule. In our case, the router connected to the backbone is R2. The second ABR must be the one violating the rule, and in our case, that's R4. That's the ABR that has no interface on Area Zero. And third, the virtual link must traverse a single area. In our case, the traversal area is Area 1. Let's take a look at the configuration in each router. One thing to keep in mind is that the virtual link is created using the OSPF router IDs assigned to each router. So for our purposes, we will explicitly configure a router ID in each of R2 and R4. Next, we issue this command here, which creates the virtual link. We start with Area 1, which is the area through which we want the virtual link to traverse, or the traversal area. Then we continue with the virtual link keyword and the router ID of the router to which we want to connect. For the configuration in R2, that would be the router ID of R4. And for the configuration in R4, it's the router ID of R2. And that's it. Assuming that OSPF is running between all these routers and adjacencies have been formed, this virtual link configuration will resolve the broken rule. Let's end off by taking a look at the resulting virtual link. With this command here, we can see in R2 that we have successfully created a virtual link with router 4.4.4.4. We can also see the adjacency state is full, which means that R2 and R4 are now OSPF neighbors. Now, just a quick note about some best practices when using virtual links. They should not be configured as a matter of course. In other words, don't plan on creating virtual links as part of your topology. Virtual links should be used as a temporary solution to immediately resolve issues and problems due to failures or due to migrations or merging of multiple networks. The OSPF areas that will be used as transit areas should be as small as possible with as few intermediate routers as possible to ensure robust communication between connected ABRs. Area 1 was used as a transit area for our virtual link, and that is what should be as small as possible. Transit OSPF areas must not be stubby. In other words, they shouldn't be any type of stub area. And that's it for OSPF virtual links. I hope you found this video useful. And if you have, I would ask that you consider using the YouTube Super Thanks feature to say thank you and support my effort to simply explain telecom and networking. As I'm always striving to improve my videos, the funds will be used to support better equipment, better quality, better video editing services, and just to produce more useful training content. And as always, check out my website where very soon you'll be able to find in-depth courses with labs, quizzes, and exams to test your knowledge and prepare you for certifications as well as for the real world of networking and telecom. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecomTech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.